Maserati name is definitely one of the royalties of the car world. Only a small number of brands out there can match the history of this Italian legend, with some of the most beautiful and fastest cars out there carrying the trident symbol as an ornament. But at the same time, Maserati has had a very harsh history, with lots of bankruptcies, and has changed ownership many times. Similarly, with many other Italian brands, Maserati has lost its magic, and so it's a bit hard to find someone to blame for the actual state that they are today, even though some clearly did more damage than the others. But anyway, hello guys and welcome back to another video, and here is the story of Maserati. Now, like I said, Maserati has a very interesting story, and this mainly due to their big family. So the history begins with the head of the Maserati family, Rodolfo Maserati. Rodolfo was a railway worker from Piacenza. He would marry Carolina Losi, and together they would have 7 children, and all were boys. So a pretty big family. The first child of the family was Carlo, born in 1881. After him came Bindo, which was born 2 years later. But their third child, Alfiero, wouldn't be as lucky as the others, since he would only die 1 year after he was born in 1886. 1 year later, the fourth child of the family was born, Alfieri II, which his parents decided to name after their lost son. After Alfieri II came Mario in 1890, while after him came Ettore 4 years later in 1894. The last child of the family was Ernesto, which was born in 1898. The first one to show a true passion for engineering and racing was of course the oldest, Carlo. Since he was a teenager, he started working for Edoardo Bianchi, where he would engineer bicycles. But at the age of only 17, Carlo built his first engine. This was a single-cylinder engine for motorized bicycles. And this can be considered the first time we see the link between Maserati and speed. But these were only the beginnings. In the late 1800s and early 1900s, Carlo would find a lot of success as a motorcycle racing pilot, when besides winning many races, he would also set many records, including here a 50 km/h top speed in 1900. The talent of Carlo would attract the attention of Fiat, which immediately hired him as a test driver, after Marquis Carcano motorcycling factory went down. But while working for Fiat, Carlo had bigger ambitions, since he wanted to build his own cars, cars that would carry on his name. And the first example of such a thing came when he built a car on his house. This car had an wooden chassis and a single cylinder engine, so not the most innovative thing in the world, but no matter what, in a sort of way, this can be considered as the first Maserati. Carlo stayed at Fiat for only a short time, since in 1903 he started working for Isotta Fraschini, when he worked again as a test driver. Meanwhile, his passion for motor racing continued to grow and grow, and when he was working for Bianchi, this time for the motorcycle division, he entered Coppa Thorio. This not to be mistaken for Targa Thorio. Coppa Thorio was the first event organized by Vincenzo Thorio. For some time, he would host both events at the same time, while Targa took place in Sicily near the hometown of Vincenzo. Coppa Thorio took place in Brescia, which at the time was the racing capital of Italy. Later, Brescia would become the starting point of Mille Miglia. Anyway, at the 1907 Targa Thorio, one of the most interesting events would happen to Carlo. This is one of those legends that has happened to all great Italian racing drivers. During the race, he was heavily annoyed by a low voltage ignition circuit breaker, which had to be replaced several times on the move, and yet, despite this, he was able to finish 7th. After this incident, Carlo began to replace the low voltage ignition systems with high voltage ones on all his cars, which effectively solved the problem. In 1908, he would become the CEO of Junior, which was a car accessories company, but he would stay there for only 1 year, since in 1909 he bought a small factory, where he started producing and modifying ignition systems. Carlo would replace low-voltage ignition systems with high-voltage ones, according to customer orders. This can be considered as the first big achievement for Maserati brothers, and something that definitely would help them on their longer road to success. But sadly, Carlo would never see this success, since he would pass away in 1910 at the age of only 29, due to tuberculosis. The torch of success was passed to Alfieri II, which would become the main figure of Maserati, and at the same time a racing legend. Thanks to the help of his older brother, Alfieri joined Carlo at Isotta Fraschini in 1903, when he was only 16 years old, which was a pretty good indicator that this guy had lots of talent. Differently from Carlo, Alfieri would continue to work for Isotta, when he would climb the stairs of success. In 1908, Isotta prepared a team of Grand Prix des Vetturettes, which was the Grand Prix of miniature cars. Alfieri only managed to finish 14th, which might sound as a terrible result, but the fact that he managed to finish this race was a win on its own right, because the carburetor of the car broke down, which caused lots of problems to him. Around this time, two more Maseratis would join Isotta, Bindo and Ettore. While Alfieri became the team mechanic, and at the same time he was developing his racing skills. But Alfieri would change position again, and until 1912 he would work as Isotta representative in Argentina, United States and United Kingdom. But in 1912 he would return in Italy, when he became head of Isotta customer service department in Bologna. But in 1913, after years of experience and probably tired from changing job position all the time, Alfieri decided to open his own shop, so he could fulfill his true dreams. And so he decided to stay in Bologna, and he rented an office space in Via De Pepoli, in the old part of Bologna. This place was the first headquarters of Società Anonima Officine Alfieri Maserati. And Alfieri also brought his two brothers, Ettore and Ernesto, from Isotta, while Bindo decided to stay there. The application for registration was sent to Bologna Chamber of Commerce and Industry on Thursday, December 1, 1914. But 5 months later, Italy was involved into the World War I, and Alfieri and Ettore were called up for the military service, while Ernesto remained in the office since he was only 70 years old. He worked in the workshop during the day and went to school of Technical Institute of Bologna in the evening. Like his brothers, Ernesto was also extremely talented. While his brothers were in the war, he developed and produced special spark plugs for engines of aircrafts, under the brand name Trucco and Maserati. But no matter what, Ernesto was still a young man, so he couldn't do everything on its own. So when Alfieri and Ettore returned from the war, the company really started to move forward. He moved the factory and the headquarters into a new place, and continued to produce and innovate spark plugs. In 1918, Alfieri patented a new spark plug design. It was a type of candle with insulation from mica, which allowed the engine to provide more constant performance, overcoming various problems previously caused by imperfect spark plugs. And so, Alfieri revolutionized the world of engines with this vital innovation. But not all the Maserati brothers were into the cars. One of them, Mario, had decided to become an artist, but Alfieri wanted also to make him part of the family business. So he commissioned him to design a logo. After the suggestion of Marquis Diego de Sterlik, a close friend and supporter of Alfieri, Mario decided to use the most characteristic symbol of Bologna, the trident from the statue of Neptune in Piazza Maggiore, a symbol of strength and energy. As a color scheme, he chose red and blue, the colors of the banner of the city of Bologna. And so, here we see the birth of Maserati as we know today, since in a very short time the Maserati brothers would introduce their first car that would carry on their name. But that's a story for another time. So guys, thank you for watching and see you next time.